Good morning, everyone. Thanks for tuning in today to our webinar, Boosting Performance in 3D Printed Mold Tools, Henkel Materials and Fortify's Flux Platform. My name is Danielle Kirshner, Marketing and Communications at Fortify, and I'll be moderating today's discussion. We have some great presenters joining us, and before I go ahead and introduce them, I just want to remind everyone that we will have a Q&A at the end, so please feel free to ask questions using the chat box at any point during today's presentation, and we'll do our best to get to every question at the end. So turning to our panelists, I would like to welcome Ben, Randy, and Daniel this morning. Ben Arnold is the VP of Business Development at Fortify. Ben has decades of experience helping manufacturing companies implement new capital equipment technology and has been on the forefront of several key 3D printing innovations serving the injection molding industry with polymer and metal 3D printing. Ben holds a BSME from WPI and an MBA from Northeastern University. Welcome, Ben. Randy Erb is co-founder of and scientific advisor to Fortify. He is currently serving as the interim materials team lead during his sabbatical from his faculty position in the Department of Mechanical and Industrial Engineering at Northeastern University. He has extensive working knowledge of composite mechanics, magnetic manipulation, and colloidal physics. Randy invented and characterized some of the underlying material systems leveraged by Fortify's Fluxprint platform. Welcome, Randy. And last but not least, Daniel Rapka, Principal Engineer, Additive Manufacturing at Henkel. Daniel's journey into 3D printing began in 2012, when as an instructor for a collegiate engineering program, he added a 3D printing lab as part of the machine shop. Since then, he has utilized rapid prototyping technologies to accelerate new product development within an agile project management structure. At Henkel since 2018, Daniel leverages over a decade of manufacturing experience to bring industrial and automotive applications into the additive manufacturing space. Welcome, Daniel. So I will turn it over to the three of you.
Excellent. Thank you, Danielle. And thanks everybody for attending. Excited to talk about our applications here today. So as Danielle mentioned, I focused mostly in the automotive space, and I spent a lot of time in production. And this isn't just production in terms of printing a part on a line. This is the full driving from concept into the production environment, which would include all the QMS elements with that as well. And prototyping serves a key component in that journey, and it really can be an accelerator if used right. Typically, we use prototyping for things like fit, for form, and maybe even for finish to understand, you know, some early design kind of concepts. But to really enhance the value of prototyping, we need to make what we call functional prototypes, or prototypes that could be used as part of the validation process. So this is the way we close the loop in the design process, and we know that, in fact, the thing that we specify is going to work in the way that we hope it will. Direct printing these parts have come a long way. Certainly for material developers like Henkel, we've been able to come close and achieve some of these material properties. But material properties that we're trying to realize aren't always the hurdle. A lot of times the hurdles are OEM specs themselves, particularly when we talk about thermoplastics. So in this case, if we want to look at prototypes that we could use for validation, we really need to look at the tooling that we use to develop these thermoplastic parts. And this tooling could be very often time and cost prohibitive. It takes time to cut these molds, and it also takes a lot of money. So this, you know, has a way of really providing these hurdles to our design cycles. And there would be a way, hopefully, that we could be able to overcome that. And 3D printing can bridge that gap, as long as we have the right material. Next slide, please. Another opportunity for prototyping is not just the part that comes off the mold, but the mold itself. So these molds, particularly in production settings, are going to be large, multi-cavity tools that are going to create many parts at once. And these molds could be in excess of $100,000, and it could take many months to cut. And if there's any kinds of mistakes associated with that, it's a big hit in time and in money. So very often, prototype molds are used to vet out design concepts, if there's any sort of near-term innovation that could be utilized. That this is something that can be done in a prototyping space. And often, you know, softer materials like aluminum are used in these prototype molds, but it still represents some time and some cost. You know, it could be in the tens of thousands of dollars, and it could be, you know, weeks to a month or two to get some prototype molding. And this is also things that are, you know, move out into the extended supply chain and add, you know, additional complexity and time with realizing your designs. Overall, what happens is that you have innovation stifled. So designers of the molds themselves can't test out new features or tweak their and apply modifications without any penalties. So being able to have something like a 3D printing platform would open up this innovation. Next slide, please. So then we enter Fortify with a really cool technology that enables us to realize 3D printing molds and take advantage of the other kinds of promises that 3D printing extols. That would namely be faster turnaround, so we could have molds in days rather than weeks or even months, a factor of 10 reduction in tooling costs, which certainly help with development cycle, and you also compress the supply chain, so you keep all this in-house. You don't have to go to an outside tool shop to have prototypes cut, and it really opens up innovation. So now, not only the designer of the part, but also the designer of the mold could have some freedom and flexibility and not suffer the same penalties with these additional iterations that you might want to utilize to develop some really novel designs. Next slide. So the Fortify Henkel partnership's been going on for about 3 years now. I had Fortify with a really cool tech that was looking for a base resin, which they could utilize to develop their directional or their controlled composites. And Henkel, of course, being a developer of custom chemistries, and it was a great match to be able to provide something that could be the foundation for their technology. And we've continued this collaboration, not only for material development, but also into application development, which I'll be happy to talk about in a little bit. That said, I'll turn it over to Randy to get into the deep dive in the material and the process.
Thanks, Dan. Fortify is a full-stack company. We built hardware, software, and materials to deliver on the promises and overcome some of the technical challenges of filled photopolymers. Filling photopolymers, and this is typically with ceramic microparticles in our case, offers a step change in functionality over the base resins. And this encompasses a range of performance metrics from thermal to mechanical to electromagnetic. Today, I'll focus on the thermal and mechanical, and specifically for the application of injection mold tooling. First, I'm going to highlight two key hardware innovations at Fortify, the CKM, or continuous kinetic mixing, and the Fluxprint, in which we texture the microstructure of 3D printed parts through the application of magnetic fields. Next, I'm going to deep dive into the thermal mechanical materials at Fortify, including our very own digital tooling resin. Hope is today we open up the hood a little and discuss the underlying physics and the relationship of those physics to the key hardware offerings of Fortify, looking at the injection molding market. Adding functional filler to a photopolymer is a performance multiplier, and it's much better to start from a high performance base material in order to get somewhere interesting. And so underlying all of Fortify's effort in tuning, aligning, and handling the functional fillers in our digital tooling resin is the fact that we are starting from impressive thermal-mechanical base resins, including Henkel's MO147 resin. Next slide, please. So on this slide, we see our two key hardware innovations at Fortify that enable us to effectively print these filled photopolymers. On the left, this is the user's view of the CKM, or continuous kinetic mixing. This is our materials handling workhorse. So our CKM will heat, mix, and deliver perfectly homogenized filled photopolymers during the printing process. It fights aggregation, sedimentation, domain formation that complicate homogeneity in colloidal suspensions. Basically, CKM ensures that the properties at the top of the part are going to match those at the bottom of the part. On the right side, we see Fluxprint in action. Here, a thick transparent resin filled with magnetically doped particles is subjected to an aligning field within the reservoir of our printer. This is a real-time video, and it really demonstrates the speed of Fluxprint. Now, in addition to Fluxprint delivering cool optics, the thermal, mechanical, and electromagnetic advantages we get from texturing our microstructure are much more compelling. At Fortify, the materials team has developed a class of magnetically doped engineering additives, spanning from carbon fiber to metal flakes to phenonic crystals that bring tunable boosts with Fluxprint. On the next slide, let's take a closer look at one of these systems. So here, if we play this video, we are applying a modest 100 Gauss magnetic field in the up-down direction to 150 micron milled carbon fiber, very polydispersed in a resin on a glass slide under a microscope. And we achieve much higher fields and much faster alignment time within our printers, but the carbon fiber here is magnetically doped with a trace dopant. And though the dopant process is proprietary and varies between the different types of particles we use, we are doing a surface treatment. And what that means is that we are positioning the trace dopants where they can apply the maximum amount of magnetic torque. And this makes our alignment very fast. This is one of the foundational innovations that inspired launching Fortify from its academic roots. At Fortify, the doping process has been made scalable and it applies to many functional ceramics, metals, and even polymeric fibers. Now, let's see why alignment matters for mechanics on the next slide. So reinforcing micron size particles can strengthen, stiffen, and toughen a base polymer if you have the right alignment. Composite mechanics tells us that applying a force to a base polymer, that load is transferred to these reinforcing particles across parallel interfaces. And so to maximize parallel interfaces and thereby maximize our load transfer, Fortify uses high anisotropy fibers, flakes, and aligns them along the principal stress direction. That would be the 0 degree case in this slide on the right. So let's watch this in action. Three identical samples in which a base photopolymer reinforced with oriented particles are at different angles. Let's play all three of these movies at once. All three materials are notched on the right, pulled in the up-down direction at the same rate. 90 degrees breaks very quickly. No real load is transferred to our reinforcing particles. The interfaces are perpendicular. 45 does a bit better. We observe some nice crack deflection. The 0 degrees has the optimum alignment and you can just feel the toughness in these structures. It does tremendously better. It has much higher strength and ductility. All of the interfaces are along that primary stress. And so this is what Fluxprint delivers. It orients fillers in optimum configurations within complex parts. And this is what 3D printing is all about, producing these complex parts. But if you don't orient your fibers along those primary stresses, then your part is going to fail prematurely. And complex parts, even under simple loads, produce complex internal stress states. And so this is what Fluxprint can deliver. Next slide, please. So clearly there are enhanced mechanical benefits of aligning reinforcing filler. It's often seen in these classic stress strain plots on the left. Reinforcement alone is stiff but brittle. A matrix alone is ductile but weak. Combining the two, we get a best of both worlds solution with composites. We have a composite that is stronger than the pure matrix and tougher than the pure reinforcement. But more than best of both worlds, discontinuous fiber composites specifically break the rules of mixture paradigm in the middle here with toughness. You have true synergy with the polymer and the ceramic working together. Composites exhibit additional toughening mechanisms versus the pure polymer and the ceramic. Things like fiber platelet pullout, crack deflection show this synergy. So we employ this strategy in Fortify's digital tooling resin. And on top of this, we also target functional filler that offers a dual thermal advantage. On one hand, our fillers increase the already impressive HDT of the base resin, which ensures that our mold geometries will stay true under heat and load. And on the other hand, our fillers have good thermal conductivity, which speaks to the thermal shock from temperature gradients, which is important for lifetime of injection mold tooling. So the benefits of micron size filler are clear. It's not the full story. There'd be a lot of competitors in the space if it was. The flip side of the coin is in the processing and the fact that it is very painful. So briefly, micron-sized particles, especially medium-density ceramics and high-density metals, sediment quickly. Coupled with that, high volume fractions of these micron-sized particles increase viscosity in a nonlinear way and also ensure that the resin is non-Newtonian. So Fortify's CKM system is designed to continuously homogenize these particle-filled resins and regulate the resin temperature to address these viscosity challenges. The particle fillers also complicate our photokinetics. Things like depth of cure and scattering are things that we have to optimize and are a crucial part of Fortify's resin development. And lastly, interface engineering is very important. In order to deliver the property benefits of functional filler, you need good connection with the base resin. And so Fortify tailors the surface chemistry of these fillers to drive improved performance. Next slide. So this has been a look at the underlying physics that Fortify considers in selecting and tailoring the functional fillers within our advanced resin. By developing the optimal functionality in our filler and driving effective microstructure, with both CKM and Fluxprint, we generally see the following performance gains. We see boosts in strength, stiffness, and wear resistance. And in regards to injection molding, we see increases in fracture toughness and heat deflection temperature. So our approach of adding functional additives to deliver these boosts is somewhat resin agnostic, but at the end of the day, these boosts are multipliers on top of the performance of the base resin. So to set us up for success, we need to use the highest performance base resins on the market. For our base resin and our digital tooling resin specifically, we teamed with Henkel and implemented a customized blend of their MO147 resin that delivers impressive strength and HDT at very low viscosity. Next slide. So next, we will walk through a couple of case studies for Fortify tools in action that leverage our digital tooling resin, like the tool shown on the left here. Again, our digital tooling resin utilizes reinforcing micron-sized particles that increase strength, stiffness, toughness, thermal conductivity, and HDT of a really great base resin. The digital tooling resin is kept homogenized throughout a print with CKM. And on top of this, Fluxprint allows the printed mold to have aligned particle reinforcement to best strengthen key features like the protrusions you see in this mold in order that it survives hundreds of shots. So I'll pass it off to Ben to walk us through some of these case studies.
Thank you, Randy. Okay, so we'll now talk about a couple case studies that we've done and move quickly through what this might mean to you callers on the phone or in the webinar today. The first, certainly a lot of medical focus in throughout the world today, but this was a project that was brought to Fortify early in the COVID situation. We were working with the ventilator project on a project of theirs, which was to bring ventilators to use refurbished tools like CPAP machines and to be used in hospitals as ventilators. That required some additional componentry for testing and alarming. And the bottom line of all that was that they needed to have a new molded part that they could complete their testing with. On the next slide, we'll look into some of the details of this. What was interesting was they brought us this project. We put out a call, basically, that we were available to help through our not just our printing capabilities, but we have an in-house molder that we made available to the Boston medical community. And we can go to the next slide. There we go. Well, one of the interesting thing was, and maybe people can identify with this early on in a project design, they weren't quite sure which of two different designs they were going with. You can see in the upper right corner of the screen, there were two different T-fittings, one with a large opening at the end and the other with a small opening. They said, can we test both of these? And we, not wanting to say no, we came up with a clever strategy to actually mold both versions of the product in the same mold. We also had some challenges around needing to shift the parting line so that the sealing surfaces that you can see with the red arrows, the yellow sealing surfaces, and the internal thread at the base all had to be produced with no parting lines so that they could be smooth sealing surfaces. So on the next slide, we'll show how we approach that. And this is, you know, one of the more clever things or questions we get asked about our tooling is, can we use inserts? Can we use it for something beyond simple open and shut type tools? And I think the answer here is yes. But again, a very clever approach here. There's actually five inserts in this part, in addition to the core and cavities sides of the mold, which in this case were kind of both cavities, and the core bits of the mold were all these hand load inserts. It looks like you see three of them clearly in the drawing there, but the left and bottom inserts are actually two pieces. So that's where the five, the total of five pieces comes from. Very clever way to again, shift the parting line so that they are away from the sealing surfaces. The threaded connector that you see in the bottom right corner, again, very simple to print. All of the components for this mold were printed in one print job. And just, you know, a very quick way to get a tool in action that not only provided one part or one set of parts, but two complete sets of parts that Ventilator Project could use to move forward. So it's a really interesting project for us. I think we'll talk on some of the economics on the next slide, exactly how we were able to pull this off. But this was, we printed all of the pieces of this and molded in-house. Fortify is not, we don't bill ourselves as an injection molding company. We do have a press in-house that we use for a lot of development work. And again, as I'm sure everyone on the call can recognize, all hands on deck when there's a project like this in the COVID era. But we were able to turn this project around in 1 week's time, 7 days, working days, 25 of each of these parts, and the total cost of $700. Now, that's the cost of everything it would have taken to print the molds and run the tool. I honestly don't remember if we charged them for this project or if we just donated it, but it was certainly a very time and cost effective way to get the parts in hand. Their estimates were, as you can see there, around just under $5,000 to do that in an aluminum tool, but more importantly, there would have been a 4 to 6 week delay in the project. So we kind of functioned as an in-house molding department on this project and had some pretty great success. So if there's questions on this particular project, we'll field them at the end. But I think we're going to move on to a second case study now. It kind of highlights a different aspect of the tool. I'm going to invite Dan Rapka to make a few more comments here as well, because we did work together on this project.
Cool. Thanks, Ben. Yeah, so this was an automotive application. So one of the products that Henkel makes is a mastic that when you put it into an oven, typically an oven used to bake paint, that it will expand to fill up voids and that provides some sealing and structural capabilities. So we need to develop these nylon carriers that hold the molded mastic in place inside of the different cavities in the vehicle while it goes into the oven. And then once the mastic expands, it takes over and provides the structure for the part. So if you look at the photos there, on the left is a sandwich. So it's two pieces of nylon. There would be a molded piece of mastic that would fit in between there, and then those two halves would snap together. If you look at the third picture, that's an actual test case where we actually 3D printed the a section of the automotive structure. So that would represent the metal beams within the vehicle. And then you could see kind of tucked down that tunnel there, there's the black plastic carrier. And then you could see it looks like foam that's been sprayed around the periphery there. That actually was expanding foam that heat up once it got in the oven. So there's really two opportunities for prototype development here. The first would be from the part design itself. So if we could produce functional prototypes that we could then put into test, as you see in that third picture, and we can validate that the foam is doing what we'd expect it to do. So there's some art associated with how that foam expands and in what direction it will expand. And we want to make sure that we get a good complete seal to seal against road noise, weather and such, and also to provide some structural stability. And then there also is an opportunity in the mold design itself, right? So if you're trying out new features, so J-clips, you know, different hooks that you have on there to snap together. If you want to utilize robots as we do on the line to assemble these together, you need to make sure that those dimensions are fine-tuned. So very often we'll go to soft tooling to be able to work through some of those design iterations before we cut a full mold. And on the right picture there, you can see, you know, an actual mold from our shop floor, a multi-cavity, you know, this is about $120,000 there. So we want to have all those things tuned and tweaked before we get to actual production. So the challenge here is really with the material that we're using. This is a glass-filled nylon, up to 35% glass fiber. So it's a very abrasive plastic to utilize, and it typically would destroy 3D printed material. So that was the concept here, is whether or not we could utilize this material in a prototype mold. And I'll turn it back over to Ben on the next slide to get into the high points.
Yeah, sure. So here's the economics on this project. The point again is time and money, right? With a Fortify tool, we are able to 5 days in this case was the time it took us to get that part turned around and shipped off to the plant in Missouri to do the mold testing. And the comparison tool, $8,000 and an 8 to 10 week lead time. So what happens is partially it's a savings of $7,500, but the reality is that it's more than that, because the $8,000 in 8 weeks is just impractical. It's too long to wait and too much money, so it doesn't happen. So the real benefits are not always about saving that much money, but all the benefits that can be realized when a mold can be validated. Right. If you were to scale up to $120,000 mold tool without doing this test, right, the repercussions there can be obviously quite harsh. So it's that this kind of testing now becomes a practical thing when the turnaround times and costs are as manageable as we're able to get them. As Daniel had mentioned, this exact tool actually in part had been tested with other 3D print technologies and had yielded zero good parts. With our tool, we actually molded 50 parts in a neat nylon 6 and then added a 35% glass-filled nylon, and we're able to mold another 50 parts. So really, you know, significant step forward. We'll talk in a minute about, you know, how do we set expectations around, you know, how many shots we might get off of one of your designs. That's, you know, these are the sort of key questions that come up. So what we'll try and do over the next segment of the webinar here is head off some of the most frequently asked questions and then open things up. So we'll move on from this one. Next slide, please. How can you get started? So the first questions that we get are like, how long does this take? What does a typical project timeline look like? And so we can see here at, you know, day one, this would be a, you know, the life of a project for someone who is a user of Fortify technology and has a printer in house. Mold design typically is it can happen in a day, can happen in as little as an hour and a half, and as long as a half a day, depending on the complexity of the tool and the experience of your designer. But then we would get that designed up day one onto a printer. The beauty of a 3D printer is it runs unattended overnight. Day two, getting the parts off of the machine. There's certainly some cleanup and post-processing that's done on the tools, but that is, again, about a 1 day's worth of work to get things ready. Day three would be fit up of components, typically some reaming of ejector pin holes and things like that that would be done to get set up into the press. A lot of that comes down to how your mold frame is designed. We have some techniques that we share in terms of how to best set up your molder or the frame on your molder to make changeover easy. And by day four, we can be molding parts. We've seen it in as little as a weekend. We've been able to go from design data for a part to molded parts delivered. We got design data on a Friday afternoon, delivered molded parts on a Monday morning. But this, I think, is a more sort of a practical timeline to turn parts around, with certainly within a week. And the next slide. I'm going to keep moving forward here. So we've come up with a best practices guide. This is available to anyone on the Fortify website. You can download this sort of best practices guide. It walks through design rules for parts. We'll hit a few of those highlights, but gating, venting, ejection strategies, cooling, part cooling operations are basically the whole gamut of press operations, how you would bring a tool up, and specifically noting the differences between a polymer-based 3D printed tool and a steel tool. Some of the highlights that we'll do, like on the next slide here, what common question, what size parts? Oh, this point here is also important. Oh, sorry, if you could go back to that. There we go. This is a couple snapshots of Fortify's in-house print and molding lab. This is really something that I think kind of sets apart what we're doing at Fortify from others. The idea of a 3D printed mold tool, we can't claim that we invented that idea. I think we certainly can claim that we've pushed the state of the art forward. And one of the big pieces of that is having an in-house molding lab where we can come up with ideas and test quickly, short circuit that loop, run complete molding jobs when appropriate. But more importantly, this is more of an R&D tool to help make sure that we're on the right track with our innovations. The next slide then talks about sort of part size and materials. And we focus on smaller parts, probably say parts that fit in the palm of your hand, 5-6 inches and below. This leads us to smaller, less expensive molds, right? The beauty of 3D printing is to be able to only use the amount of material needed to make the mold. The complexity is a non-factor in the cost of a mold, only the overall size. So smaller molds help print fast and save money on the tool cost. And then, of course, that it also leads to lower pressure and smaller shot sizes, less heat to dissipate, and less overall operating, lower overall operating pressures, all contribute to higher shot sizes and greater success with the application. Quick chart on the next slide, just kind of rules of thumb that we would use as we sort of climb up the ladder or the triangle of from the base sort of common materials like TPUs and polypropylenes through ABSs and into some of the more and most challenging materials, glass-filled nylons, ultems, and other higher temp materials. We range from hundreds of shots of from expectations on, at the easy end of the pyramid, and dozens of shots as we climb up the ladder of performance. And again, if we follow the rules for venting, gating, and draft angles, et cetera, we can cheat those numbers even higher. So how do we learn how to do that? That will be the next slide. What we've learned over time in doing this is that to transfer the knowledge to a customer to really understand how to best utilize this technology, and if the technology is a good fit for your needs, we take a very comprehensive approach with an onboarding program. So we don't typically respond to a request for, hey, I'd like to print this mold and see how it works. We take a comprehensive approach, work hand in hand with our customers through two complete projects. We do help do the mold design. We walk through gating and venting strategies, any mold design tweaks that we might do to get higher performance or more shots from the tool, and really help set expectations of what is the sweet spot of the technology and how far it can be pushed. And that's really been a tremendous help with us. It helps us really set the expectations. This is not a drop-in or plug-and-play type operation, but a new tool that, if you're willing to take the time to invest and learn how to use it, can really separate yourselves from your competitors or bring an in-house advantage to accelerate product development. And so that's I think that's pretty much the presentation that we have today, and certainly Q&A is usually the most important and interesting segments of the session, so we can segue into that and any questions that would be on your minds for either Randy, Daniel, or myself.
Thanks, Randy, Ben, and Daniel. We're going to open up the Q&A now, and I'll go ahead and ask the questions, and any of you can answer any of them. So the first question I have here is, what material is shown for the competitive 3D printed tool in reference to the mask project, I believe?
The mask project, you said?
Yeah. I'm not sure. I'm just reading the question here. The reference to the mass project.
Oh, so we focused on two projects through the the presentation today. It was probably the ventilator project. That was polypropylene. I think that was. I hope that was the question, because that is, if that was the question, that's the answer.
Are you actively cooling the mold between shops?
Yeah, I can answer that one. The answer is we do. We cool the mold between shots with compressed air on the surface, which is a little bit of a shift from metal tools typically that might be cooled with water lines. What we find with these tools is the heat does tend to stay near the surface of the tool, and a simple compressed air setup does a great job of removing the heat from the surface. We do run a bit longer cycle times than we would with metal tools, but that's again the focus here is getting first shots in your hand as quickly as possible, and one of the trade-offs is cycle time per shot.
What types of applications are best suited for the Fortify process?
So I think that relates to molding. I think we'll interpret it that way, right? Because there's a suite of applications that our core technology of CKM and Fluxprint help us go after, which probably is a topic for another day. Certainly, the Fortify website would help understand sort of some of the other application classes where the technology can be applied, but I think we'll interpret that question here as it relates to molding and the applications best served, which would be typically it's the prototype phase of injection molded parts, where the need to be able to get a short run, a handful of parts that can be used for functional testing as early in the product development life cycle as possible.
And I would also add to that to be able to innovate mold design, right? So typically when you're adding new features, different kinds of clips and, you know, snap features and such, that mold designers will rely upon kind of a standard palette of these features to utilize because the design geometry has already been vetted. Whereas you could use this technology to also develop, you know, new innovative kinds of features and have some runway in terms of the compression and time and cost to evaluate these new innovations.
Thank you. Another question came in. How long does it take to prepare a tool design to be ready for injection molding?
So I'll field that one. As we showed in the presentation here, it can be as little as an hour to an hour and a half for a simple open and shut tool. Sometimes we'll get a little more creative with insert designs and things of that nature, and those can stretch into three or four hours. Again, that's the assumption there is that we're dealing with someone who has the basic skills of mold design. So somewhere between an hour and 4 hours is what we're seeing when we are asked to do that work.
Are the design techniques for a 3D printed mold the same as for a metal mold?
So there are some, they're the same basic concepts, but we would, in the guidelines, we sort of go into the details of how we would approach them. So all of the same considerations need to be factored into the design, but we would, for instance, typically be a little more generous with a gate design would be one example, right? Where in a production tool, the gate design is typically designed to leave no trace where the gate would be. That would be like, in many cases, an ideal design. And in the 3D printed tool, if we're only going to worry about making, say, 50 shots, the gate is one of the highest stress or probably the highest stress component in a mold design. If we're a little more generous in our design of the gate, it may mean that we have to trim the gate from the parts. You wouldn't want to trim the gate from 200,000 parts, but if it's 200 parts or 20 parts, that can be a very reasonable trade-off. So that's just like one example of the sort of design considerations that you might attack a little differently with a 3D printed tool.
I'd also say that there's some freedom in that you're unhooked, as you typically are an additive, from the artifacts of standard manufacturing, right? So, you know, typically there'll be some remnant of, you know, drills or reams or end mills that reside within your molds, particularly when you talk about things like gate design and such. And you could, you know, unshackle yourself, if you will, from those kinds of geometries, right? As you now have more freedom in the kinds of shapes that you can incorporate into your design. So there's a value there as well.
What is the lowest tolerance you can expect on the printed tool? Our tooling requires close fits for tight part tolerance.
So I'll field that one. Typically, we're going to, our mold printing process will hold about plus or minus 5,000, so which in some cases is perfectly adequate for tooling and in some cases is not. If there's a few key measurements that need to be in spec, post-processing is sometimes a way to do that. The tools can be post-machined after printing. And sometimes there's just a few key tolerances. We can leave extra stock and machine those afterwards. And in some cases, if it's like a really intricate part with super tight tolerances throughout, it's just not a good fit. So we just, again, that's part of our onboarding process, or even, you know, pre-onboarding process would be to set up a call with a customer and review the parts. And, you know, we're pretty good at looking at parts and, you know, making a reasonable estimate of, is it a good fit for the process? And is it a good fit for the quantities required? Sometimes, you know, the part will be a good fit. We also have to make sure that in the materials and the desired quantities are all sort of in that reasonable spectrum.
That's a good segue to our next question on how long is the Fortify onboarding process?
The typical onboarding process to work through two projects with a customer takes about between 6 and 8 weeks. Sometimes we can move a little faster. Sometimes it might take a little longer. It's really hard. Like the last 9 months of business has been anything but business as usual. So scheduling has been, you know, challenging for us, challenging for our customers. Maybe we're a little hard to give a straight answer based on what's happened over the last months. But the goal would be somewhere in that 6 week time frame.
Does Fortify do the mold design?
So we will do mold design. It all is a matter of meeting customers in a practical, logical path, right? Our goal and our business model is to sell 3D printers. So, if we take on mold design, you know, the big question is, hey, who's going to take mold design on, you know, in real life, right, after the onboarding program? Again, it all just comes down to having a plan that works for us and that works for the customer. So we do have the capabilities. Typically, it's a shared effort, like an exercise back and forth. Part of the onboarding process is teaching best practices in mold design, and that's the best way to do that, in our opinion, is to collaborate on a design. There you go. Long answer to a short question.
Another question about, are there any other medical device 3D printing projects Fortify is currently working on?
Yes, is the answer. The challenge is being able to talk about them. So this is an open invitation to everybody on the call. If you have a project that you'd like to work on that is not a secret, we're super interested to talk to you about that. That is one of the challenges of any kind of new technology company is you get involved in a lot of really interesting projects, and you're not allowed to talk about them. So the answer to the question is yes, we're involved in other projects, some related to COVID, you know, many that are just sort of standard medical device companies that are looking to implement these technologies. We do certainly have a lot of interest from the medical device community. It's a market where there's a lot of product development going on, a lot of parts that fit our sweet spot, and a lot of the materials that we're experiencing and running. So, yes, is the answer.
What is the smallest wall thickness tested for printed tooling?
Well, again, it's one of those gray area answers because it's aspect ratio of the wall. It's what's the material that we're molding. We've gone down about 0.5 millimeter in a wall thickness. But, you know, it comes to pressure and the ability to pack out a mold. As the walls get thinner and materials get more challenging to mold, that answer yields towards the thicker side. Everything points back to why that onboarding program and why the need to set expectations around specific designs and not just make a general claim about what's possible.
Can Fortify do a complete molding job for us?
Yeah, I think as we've shown here in the presentation, we definitely have the capability to do complete molding jobs. It's not our primary business, so we do that kind of work where strategically is a practical thing, or when we can help the community, as we did with the ventilator project.
So I'll take one more question, and then I think we can wrap up here. So I believe this was answered in the presentation, but might want to review this again, Ben. How many shots can a mold tool printed with this process withstand?
How many licks does it take to get to the center of a Tootsie Roll? So we've molded up to 1,000 parts. So that we stopped at 1,000. We didn't try and go further. The question really is, not to be a wise guy, but the question really is very much dependent on the design, the material that's being molded, and the ability to sort of adopt some of the best practices, right? So you don't always have to adopt all of the best practices in our application guideline, but to the extent that, for instance, that we expand draft angles from 0.5 degree to 2 or 2.5 degrees, you'll get more shots. Again, it sounds like a broken record, but the onboarding program, like, this is why we need to dig into specific designs and specific customer applications, right? So we're more than happy to set up a call with, you know, anybody here. This is what we do. This is how we, you know, sort of vet out the application. Both, is it a good fit for Fortify, and are we a good fit for your application as a customer? Is through the engineering analysis of looking at typical parts from your process and understanding where the pain points are in your product development process, and say, okay, this may or may not be a solution for your needs. But for a growing number of inquiries we're getting, you know, we really do have a sort of unique and really valuable solution. So we welcome the more detailed questions. We're not trying to be evasive here. It's just, it depends. We can answer the questions, but we need a little more deeper dive on your needs.
All right, thanks, Ben. Sounds like a lot of answers are tied up in that onboarding program. So I do want to encourage anybody who has additional questions getting into some of those finer details to reach out. You can see the emails here for Ben, Randy, and Daniel. Feel free to use those emails. A recording will also be available of this webinar, so you can review those highlights again at your leisure. And I want to thank everyone for joining and tuning in. I hope you have got some good information, a little bit of a sneak peek into the Fortify and Henkel collaboration, and specifically around mold tooling. So thanks again to our presenters for taking the time to share this. And we hope to hear from everyone soon. So please feel free to send emails out, check out Henkel or Fortify website for more details, and have a great rest of your day.
Take care, y'all.
Thank you, Danielle. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.